The pressure is off. No, but in all seriousness, I think gatherings like this are so important because I feel a long way from home when I'm in London. But I am definitely amongst friends and comrades in this room. And I think when things are so hard, it is hard being a socialist. It's hard understanding the system, understanding the establishment. And in my lowest moments, I remember moments like this, all of these wonderful socialists in this room, and you will all go out and do wonderful things and fight to transform this system. It really does give me power and strength, and I hope it does to you too, to be in this room. And all power to the PPC for Harlow, because no matter how nice a Tory MP is, they always vote against the interests of working class people. But she should be in this room. Around is one thing that has been consistent is the meltdown that the Tory party are in. They are in disintegration. And last night they had to put two Tories on question time because they're so divided. And we need to recognise that meltdown is happening, and it has been happening for some time. And why do we need to get this message out? Well, just imagine if it was a socialist government in this mess. Just imagine if there were MPs handing, well, we don't need to imagine, you know, we'd have to have some drama of our own. And there was furore, was there not, in the media. But because of their natural arrogance, the leading lights of the Tory party, they carry on as if nothing were happening at all. Just the odd gaffe here and there, a little bit of a spat, but nothing to worry about, and that the status quo will be restored soon enough. That's what they genuinely believe. They do not understand that we are on the precipice of great change. And much of the Westminster press go along with that, don't they? They go along with that charade. So we can have a Tory party that's tearing itself apart, mass resignations, a government who are bringing zero legislation. We can have a candidate to be our next Prime Minister who believes that abortion limit should be half to 12 weeks, or one that calls Muslim sister comrades letterboxes, and yet they act as if nothing has happened. The threshold for what it is to be an incompetent government has been ramped right up, has it not? You know, had the Windrush scandal, the hostile environment for the DWP, for people within the social security system, which actually offers no security whatsoever. Think about Jodie Whittaker, a young woman who took her own life because her payments got stopped, because she didn't attend an assessment, because she had pneumonia and was in hospital. You would think that would cause the collapse of a government. That one life needless you lost. But they remain in power. And I think that this is not just about the media supporting what, you know, we like to call gaffes, or they like to call gaffes. Through this horror show, we have Boris Johnson potentially, or probably, most probably going to become our Prime Minister. But all of this chaos is just an outward expression of what's really happening. And what is really happening is the disintegration of their ideology. Because they can be beaten, and they know this, they can be beaten every single time with their rotten politics. When we take them head on, they have not a leg to stand on. Because the Tory belief system, one of neoliberal economics, of the quick profit, outsourcing, the privatisation, of cutting costs, of austerity, of the small state, of slashing red tape. Can you remember Eric Pickles? Can you remember that ridiculous red tape challenge? Can you remember one of the requirements of that, that any new piece of legislation to protect people, let's be honest, in the workplace or at home, you have to get rid of two pieces of legislation? That was actually a rule at one point. And we have Grenfell, you know, a symbol of our time, of people not being listened to. People not being listened to when they were telling the truth about their accommodation. Generations of deregulation to make homes safe, and they were not listened to. And we saw that catastrophe that happened on that night. 72 lives needlessly lost because people were not listened to, and neoliberalism, deregulation, privatization was the lead. We have this extreme individualism where it's sink or swim, of the cutting down of local services, some landlords in the free market, and extracting as much profit as possible for workers. All of that has failed spectacularly. It's failed and they know it. So those people who build their whole political project on an economic model that has let people down so spectacularly, where do they go now? What have they got left? How? They're reduced to promoting populist characters like Boris Johnson, Farage and Trump, who have absolutely no answers to any of the problems that face this country, but just trying to preserve that big money in the status quo. They find horses to ride, which they hope will distract the general public, distract the majority of people, working class people, who share no interests at all with these bloated, privileged, super rich figures. And Brexit is one such horse, and that has been mentioned here tonight. We now have a majority of Tory MPs who are falling behind Boris Johnson and his reckless plan to take us out of the European Union without even a deal, because they think it can attract disillusioned leaders. And let's be honest, because Boris knows he's going to have to appease Farage at some point. A sort of deal is about to be done between Boris and Farage. But I'm confident, with all of that doom that I've just laid out, I'm confident that any respite they get will be very temporary. And why do I have such confidence? Well, for two reasons. Firstly, what we were able to do, all of us in this room, when there was a general election, we were able to communicate the policies that actually spoke to people's needs. And can you remember that feeling when the manifesto was leaked and we were able to go out on the doors? The uplift, the positivity, the optimism. No longer were we just saying, well, we're not going to be as bad as the Tories. There was a fundamental difference in our politics. People responded to a £10 an hour raise, to the renationalisation of the railways, to bringing back public services into public control, including the NHS, to a tax policy that targets the very rich and closes those tax loops, to a foreign policy based on peace, not on war. And can you remember the scrutiny that Jeremy Corbyn was under, as though he was somebody who was completely wrong, that he wouldn't commit to obliterate the planet, that it was him who was in the wrong. And when the world is turned upside down in such a way, we know we have such a huge fight in front of us. But really basic things that affect people, morally abhorrent things, like car parking charges, you know, where you have to pay when your loved ones are sick and tired and trying to heal, and you're scrabbling around trying to find some money, and then you find. We were saying absolutely no to that at one point. That would have been difficult for the Labour Party to stop the charges on car parks in hospitals, but no more. And we talked about all of those things and so much more, and it spoke to people. Our alternative modes of ownership, our anti-imperialism, our workers' rights and our climate change deal cannot be matched by any other political party. And secondly, unbeatable, because since the last general election, we've been working so hard, all of us, on taking those brilliant ideas from the last manifesto and putting so much more meat on the bones. And I know that my team and I on the Ministry of Labour have been working day in, day out to make sure that we have an unbelievable, revolutionary offer for working class people in that next general election. And we have been developing plans for a future Labour government that will change our countries, our communities and our workplaces for generations to come. We'll see the biggest transformation in society since 1945. 45. Change the way that disabled people are treated, reinstate our national health service and invest in our region. There will be a collective sigh of relief on that day when Jeremy Corbyn is in number 10 Downing Street. There will be a sigh of relief. Can you imagine it? And not only a sigh of relief, a breath of fresh air will be blown across the United Kingdom. So we have a very urgent matter as socialists in this room. We have a leader, a prime minister, about to commit to a no-deal Brexit. We have a fraud, a charlatan, a cheap Boris, you know, riddled with Etonian prejudice, isn't he? Mm-hmm. Prejudice of working class communities, of foreign lands. He is riddled with prejudice. And he is comfortable, relaxed about Donald Trump sniffing around our NHS. Boris will be no defence to our NHS. It is us, it is we in this room that will be the defence of our NHS, because we have no option than to fight this. I think we should be absolutely confident that it will happen sooner or later if we keep that united front, if we understand what the real political challenges are in front of us, the real political challenges, that we stay focused, and we will replace this tired, empty, and self-indulgent government with one of the most hopeful and transformational governments of our history. And the saying goes, it's always the darkest just before dawn, and dawn is coming, comrades.